Stanford University.
Today we welcome Aaron Koblin. Aaron's the technology lead at Google Creative Labs. And one of the projects he worked on was Chrome Experiments, which is a website showcasing JavaScript work by designers from around the world. His artwork has been shown all over the world, including Ars Electronica, SIGGRAPH, is it OFF? OFF?
Yeah, OFF.
Japan Media Arts Festival, and TED. His work is actually part of the permanent collection at MoMA in New York. And more recently, he's been getting into music videos. He produced a video, helped produce a video for Radiohead, and recently a video on Johnny Cash. And you'll be talking about that today and other things. Welcome.
Wonderful. Thanks for having me. can everybody hear me all right? I have a tendency to talk quietly. So I'd be happy to keep this somewhat informal. If anybody has any questions while I'm talking, feel free to interrupt. I'll also do a Q&A at the end. So I'll start off with a quote from Lev Manovich. He says, "In the 19th century was defined by the novel. 20th century was culture of cinema. And in the 21st century, culture will be defined by the database." And I think we might be able to take this idea one step further and say the 21st century may be defined by the interface. I think that no longer are interfaces just kind of methods of getting access to data, but they're actually narrative storytelling devices within themselves, or at least they can be. I won't go too far into this idea of discussing how much data there is right now. We're kind of all, especially in this crowd, familiar with the vast amounts of data, computer-mediated interactions, both between people and people, people and computers and computer to computer, that are leaving massive amounts of extremely interesting data for us to visualize and play with. And it's telling really interesting stories that haven't necessarily been kind of discussed or been tangible or analyzable throughout the course of human history. So it's kind of an exciting time. So I'm going to talk about a few of the different software projects that I've worked on over the last several years. And they can roughly be divided into two categories. More kind of literal data visualization, kind of exposing trails and traces of data, and also systems that are kind of sitting on top of other systems to create software, basically like new data sets and visualizations of those data sets, which are often a critique of themselves. But I'll talk about that more in a minute. So this is a project that I worked on in 2005. This is looking at air traffic over North America. So what you're seeing right now are people going to sleep. You see everything kind of becomes black. And you'll catch red-eye flights moving from the West Coast over to the East Coast. People wake up in the morning on the East Coast right there. You see European flights coming in on the upper right-hand corner. It's a little bit washed out. Hopefully you see it. And then down here on the left side, eventually the West Coast moving down to Hawaii here in the corner. And you see a tally of how many planes are being tracked over the 24-hour period. So this data comes from the FAA in a feed called the ASDI feed. And I think it's one thing to say there's 141,000 planes in the sky above us, but it's an entirely different thing to see the system as it kind of ebbs and flows and get a sense of all the intricacies and be able to actually dive in and see each airport and how it kind of functions over time. So this is another image looking at the same data with a 24-hour time lapse. And it's color-coded by type, so you can see which type of aircraft is moving over which area. This is a look at specifically the New York region. This was for Wired magazine. You can see kind of the intense traffic that air traffic controllers are dealing with around those three airports. I started to look at other parameters like altitude. So this is showing, this is pretty washed out. I don't know if we can maybe dim the lights or not, but what you see is the white spots represent airports where the planes are descending into those locations, and the blue lines represent higher altitude flights. That was a look at Florida. This is a look at the West Coast. You see San Francisco Bay Area up there, Los Angeles here, Nevada, kind of a large no-fly zone. This is looking at Atlanta, which is obviously a heavy traffic zone, especially for packages and shipping. You see here the patterns of the landing patterns of descent. This is looking at the East Coast again, New York, some of the chaos up there, crowded skies. I took this data and made a Google Maps mashup. So you can basically pan around the entire country, find specific airports, and zoom into them. And again, you can look at the altitudes and the landing patterns. And you can also toggle by altitude, model, and manufacturer. And you can see different kind of methods of looking at the airports and the activity. This is another shot of Atlanta looking at takeoffs versus landings. And there's a version of this that plays out over time. If you can make that out, you can see the basically the airport, you have landings happening headed east. Takeoffs headed east and landings headed east. And then over time, the airport actually switches, and you'll see a bunch of holding patterns pop up. Occasionally, you'll see up there and down here these little swirly things, which you'll see in a second. The airplanes begin holding patterns, and then the whole airport will actually flip and reverse directions over time. Let's see if I can. Yeah, so you saw that flip. And there's a holding pattern right there. You see a bunch of them popping up. So this is another project that I worked on with a group at MIT called the Sensible Cities Lab. This was for an installation in the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And basically, this globe is looking at international communications from New York City. So not looking at, it's looking at how New York communicates with non-US, major non-US cities over time. So this is looking at IP traffic total. It also looks at divided flow for email, BitTorrent, and a couple other categories. And you can see the changing relationship with New York to the other cities over time, and see as the time of day shifts, how that relationship changes. We also took a look at long-distance phone call data. This is looking at at each individual borough in New York and dividing that into subsections. So you can see this portion of this borough is communicating to this section of the world, and you get kind of this breakdown of the top cities that portion of New York is communicating with. So it's a little bit of a sociological perspective as seen through the demographic, or demographic perspective as seen through the infrastructure of AT&T. This is another project that I worked on with MIT, taking data from KPN Telecom. This is looking at SMS messages sent in the city of Amsterdam. So what you're seeing is kind of this daily ebb and flow of people sending text messages from different parts of the city. And then what you'll see here is New Year's Eve, everybody, Happy New Year, sending to each other. And this is another holiday. this is Queen's Day. So you see, again, this kind of daily ebb and flow, people sending text messages from different parts of the world. And then you'll see them gather in the center of the city the night before, begin partying. It's just going to be like right there. And then the next day, you see everybody's partying in the middle of the city, right there, sending text messages to each other. So it comes from basically triangulation from what are called best serving areas. You get cell phone towers that you can gauge signal strength and figure out basically where people are. And that's built into specific regions. Then I'm quantifying taking the value for that region and creating points both by density and color, and then creating the height. So it looks like the cityscape. Afterwards, I can actually load up the app. It's an interactive app, so you can move around it and play back and forward through time. It's slightly more analytical. This is a product, if you're not familiar with it, at Google called TV Ads. And it's kind of a great place to work at Google because there's tons of exciting, like crazy information to play with. This is basically this product allows advertisers to do targeted placement so that you can get a sense of who's watching what when. And these are some of the graphs that have been made by the TV Ads team looking at basically viewership and allegiance. So you see here on the left, I didn't make these, by the way, but this is... viewership for Playboy, kind of not a lot of allegiance. But at CNBC, you get weekly tune-ins, and you get a lot of viewership in these kind of discrete patterns. And it got me thinking about what's actually happening here and the way that the data is probably really rhythmic. And it also varies a lot, obviously, by channel. So I'm not a sound designer by any stretch of the imagination. I apologize for what this sounds like. But it seemed like this might be data that could be interesting sonically. Because of its rhythms. So this is a look at Oxygen TV Network. So what you see here is the week progressing from left to right with quantities of viewers being represented, and then that's affecting the pitch. So you kind of get this interesting cycle of interest. So this is Oxygen, which kind of has some diversity of content and programming. This is Bloomberg, a totally different picture. You get this daily monotonous drone until the weekend, there's nothing at all. Maybe back to the weekdays and get the same kind of drone. And there's lots of different patterns that you see. These are a few normalized looks at the patterns of viewership on each of the different channels. Some of them are very rhythmic and have a really nice cycle. I was thinking about how you could kind of layer them on top of one another. Other ones, this is CNN, which is very event-driven. So what you get are kind of spikes. Something interesting happens. Everyone tunes in, like the inauguration. This is a look at more than double peak traffic for watching Obama. This is another very quick stab at trying to look at the allegiance. And it's basically showing users that tune in at this time also tune in at this time. So you see very low allegiance on Playboy Channel. Whereas Armenian TV, you have everybody watching all the time because that is the option in their language. And in Bloomberg, you get a similar kind of allegiance, but only at these specific periods during weekdays, kind of keeping track of what's going on. So on to something completely different. This is Baron Wolfgang von Kempelen's mechanical chess playing machine, which a lot of you are probably familiar with at this point. This is basically a robot that plays chess, except that it's not a robot at all. There's a legless man that sits in this box and controls this thing. this was the inspiration for a web service by Amazon called Mechanical Turk. Some of you may have used it. This was released when I was a grad student at UCLA in a program called Design Media Arts. Premise of it is artificial intelligence. So you can pay people to do things, and you can kind of treat them like computers. They say do things that are, you know, easy for people, hard for computers, get paid to do it. And I was really kind of, I think as I said, I'm about half art student. I was about half art student, half nerd. So part of me was extremely excited by this. Like, this is an amazing ability to harness like the power of the masses and this human brain power. And part of me saw this dystopic future where we'd all be kind of sucked into this system being used for our brains with no idea why or what we're doing and kind of pecking away at the ones and zeros. So I decided to try to visualize the system and made this task, said, draw a sheep facing to the left and I'll pay you 2 cents. And there was no other context given. It was just this simple drawing tool with size and grayscale slider. And I started collecting different people's drawings. These are a few of the first sheep that came back from the Mechanical Turk system. Of course, I was kind of amazed and delighted that this was actually working. And I began collecting more and more sheep. A lot of sheep. I took the first 10,000 sheep that I collected and put them on a website called thesheepmarket.com, where you can see this gigantic matrix. And in addition to kind of seeing this mechanized system of sheep, you can roll over each individual and see the process that went behind creating each one. And I think there's something about this juxtaposition that really drives home kind of the humanity behind the system, where you're able to actually see the person's struggle, you know, the individual struggle to create this thing, something that each of us is used to seeing ourselves go through, but not necessarily used to watching how other people tackle the task. The other thing I should mention is that I paid 2 cents for each sheep, but then when I put them up online for sale, I put them at grossly inflated prices where people couldn't pick individual sheep to buy, but bought blocks of 20 in this kind of exploitative manner. And people were kind of irate. This is a smarmy capitalist bastard. He's selling our sheep. And they didn't realize, of course, that they clicked the terms of service box that said that they sold their sheep already by the time they collected their 2 cents. So anyway, this are a few stats from the project. This is an average rate of 11 sheep per hour were coming in, which makes an average wage of 69 cents per hour. And there were 662 sheep that didn't meet sheep-like criteria and were thrown out of the flock. a lot of different motivations. There were kind of 46 minutes was the longest time spent drawing, and 4 seconds. And the guy who spent 4 seconds on the sheep also drew the maximum of 5 allotted sheep per person. There were 7,599 participants, or rather unique IP addresses, so that's about how many individual people participated. But of all those 7,000 people, only one of them asked this, which I was really surprised. I kind of expected a lot more of that, but everybody else seemed to draw really nice sheep. There's a lot of reasons that I chose sheep. One is the first animal to be raised for mechanically processed byproducts. First animal to be selectively bred for production traits. First animal to be cloned. And they're obviously recognized as kind of having a connotation of being a follower. And there's this reference to the book Le Petit Prince where he draws sheep after sheep. And the narrator, or the prince is only finally appeased when the narrator draws a box and says, use your imagination.
Are there other things that were not cheap that didn't satisfy these criteria? Did you come to this later?
You mean in terms of the screening process or before even creating the task?
Yeah, before you decided on a sheep.
So I did one other experiment, which I'll show in a second, and I honestly can't remember which came first. If it was, I think the sheep were actually the first, very first experiment that I did with the Turk.
What you describe here is sort of looking back on it. This is a good reason that I did choose a sheep as a topic.
I see what you're saying. Did
you consider a lot of different things than you
before?
You tried all of these criteria. Is it a recognized symbol or a follower?
I think when I first saw the Mechanical Turk and it created a drawing tool, I was trying to come up with, you know, what should I do? How should I engage these people? And I think sheep just kind of made sense. I was really curious to see if people would actually draw the sheep or if they would be kind of insulted a little bit or you know, what kind of reaction people would have to that. Like, you're being kind of used in a way in this really weird system. I think sheep was actually the first request that I made, and it was definitely deliberate in this, like, how are people going to react to it? The second experiment I did was actually with related to this clip, which is from Modern Times. It's a film with Charlie Chaplin's dealing with the changes during the Industrial Revolution, where people were kind of no longer shoemakers, but now they're slapping soles on shoes, and he's physically being pushed through this factory gears, kind of showing his changing relationship with his job and how much he's struggling with that. So I took this frame, divided it into 16 pieces, and fed it into the Mechanical Turk, so nobody had any idea what it was that they were working on. Again, this is the original frame, and this is the frame as drawn by 16 people, and paid them 5 cents for each contribution this time. This was kind of the inspiration behind a project that I worked on with my friend Takashi Kawashima, where we decided to just use the Mechanical Turk for exactly what it was meant for, which is making money. So we took that quite literally, and we took a $100 bill and divided it into 10,000 pieces, which makes each piece have a value of 1 cent. And we paid that 1 cent to workers on the Mechanical Turk to recreate the bill. So what you see here are individual little drawings being made. Nobody has any idea what it is they're creating. And they're building out this $100 bill. And that $100 bill then was put on a website called 10,000cents.com, where you could again browse each individual contribution. And you could also trade real $100 bills for these forged $100 bills and make a donation to the $100 laptop project, which is now known as One Laptop Per Child. And what you see here is some of the individual contributions. This is somebody who did a stipple rendition, a very highly detailed, pretty nice job, if I do say so. The difference being here, everything was included. So some people, you have kind of crazy, really nice versions, and you have stick figures and smiley faces, and this guy wrote, 1 cent, really? That's all you're gonna pay me? And the difference with this project to the sheep market was, in the sheep market there were sheep that didn't meet sheep-like criteria and were thrown out of the batch. But here you're seeing a visual representation of how well people did what it was they were asked to do, because this is including all of the submissions into the drawing. And this is all the people actually drawing together to make the massive distributed forgery. So now I'll talk about another experiment I did with the Mechanical Turk with a friend of mine named Daniel Massey. And this is Max Matthews at Bell Labs in 1962, where he created the world's first singing computer. And he chose this song, Daisy Bell, which you might be familiar with from 2001 Space Odyssey. At the end of the film, when Hal's dying, he's singing this song. And it's kind of a callback to basically when computers became human. I was really interested in this idea of computers pretending to be like humans and humans pretending to be like computers, and kind of how those distinctions were becoming increasingly less significant and blurred, and kind of what it means to be emulating one or another. So he synthesized the original song, Daisy Bell. You hear it here, similar to the one that Max Matthews made at Bell Labs.
Daisy, give me your answer through.
We took all of these individual notes from the synthesized song, and we fed them into the Mechanical Turk through a little Java-based tool like this. So you go to Mechanical Turk, you get a code, you type it into this tool, and you test out your microphone.
Hello, hello.
And you're given this clip, and you do your best to emulate that into the microphone. Once you've confirmed that it's to your liking and it's adequate, then you submit it into the Mechanical Turk. And we basically we collect them and reassemble them. This is what one collection of those first sound samples sounds like? So then we decided, you know, James Surowiecki has this idea of wisdom of crowds, and when you get lots of people working together, it's got to get better. So we took the original sound clip, and on the website, Bicycle Built for 2000, you can actually click on any individual note and see all the different interpretations of that one note. And we also fed in all the music, so we had these little phonemes, and people would emulate the tones. And we stacked up a couple thousand of them on the website, and it sounds something like this. So if you have a chance to go to bicyclebuiltfor2000.com, it's actually a little bit spatialized, and if you get headphones, you'll have a much more painful experience, I think, which I recommend. So stepping back a minute, I used to work at the Center for Embedded Network Sensing at UCLA. I was creating software to visualize laser scanners. So we had this robotic NIMS node that would pass through areas shooting a laser beam and collecting those distance points to kind of recreate scenes. This was used for a bunch of different research, looking at landslides and how sun penetrates rainforest canopies, things like that. But in addition to those kind of more practical uses, I thought that these images were coming out kind of beautiful and really interesting. So I set up an installation at the center where, as people entered, they would leave traces of their body through space, and making kind of these three-dimensional sculptures. And this was seen by a music video director in LA, and he basically said, oh, wow, we can shoot a video without video. That's pretty cool. So after a few discussions, we found out that he knew someone who knew someone who knew Radiohead, and they're one of my favorite bands, so obviously I was excited to work with him to build a music video for the House of Cards. This is just a really short clip from that project. Forget about your House of Cards. So basically, we used a couple different technologies to create the project, collected different data. This is a structured light scanner, which I'll talk about in a second. This is also the LiDAR system. So it's an array of 64 lasers that's spinning around, collecting distance points, not so different from what I was doing at UCLA. We used it in two methods. This is showing it kind of tied to the back of a truck, which we pulled through these scenes to collect data points. So once again, the structured light scanner is basically throwing light patterns onto Tom York and various other people. And it's basically calculating mesh geometry, which we use to create these renders of faces and other things. The second technology was a LiDAR laser scanner, which is basically 64 lines of lasers that are spinning out, collecting distance points. And the first way we used it was upright like this. So as it's spinning, it's constantly updating at 60 or 90 frames a second, collecting updating distance points. So it works a little bit like a camera, and then you get this frame sequence of updating data. The other way we used it was put it on the back of a truck and drove it through a scene and just did point accumulation. So we're just building up this big point cloud of data and collecting cityscapes and various other scenes. What we were really interested in was kind of ways that rather than kind of taking the data and then putting it into post-production and making it crazy, we could actually make reality crazy and then have the data reflect that. What I mean by that was, like, when we were scanning Tom York, we set a plate with water that we were drizzling down and kind of capturing all these bizarre naturally occurring artifacts, which ended up being more bizarre, I think, than it had we brought it into post and used algorithms to simulate bizarreness. I mean, I think that's also kind of a nice analog to the way that Tom York and the rest of the band creates their music, is they kind of use instruments in ways they weren't necessarily intended. So for instance, if you were going to make a scan like this for a survey purpose, you'd mount the laser on like a gyroscopic balancer and you'd record offset and you'd make sure that everything was perfect. But I actually really like the fact that when we just drilled it onto a board and stuck it on the back of the thing, as you're rolling over the bumps on the ground, you're actually seeing those bumps reflected in the telephone wires. And you get all kinds of like really interesting deformation that just happens by looking at how reality really is. So we took that data, and I also made a version that lives online. This is a project I made with my friend Aaron Myers, and it's a 3D Flash Player interactive version of the video. So you can look at all the cityscapes kind of in real time with your mouse and choose what you're looking at while you're watching the video. And then you can also stream the data of Tom singing and actually decide which angle you want to look at it, or potentially even go inside of his head, do other interesting stuff. But my favorite part of this project was that we released it as an open source project on Google Code. So we took all the data, we released the video, the making of, and we also released a bunch of the data and some code so that people could build their own versions of the video and set up a YouTube channel where people could post some of their experiments. These are actually two of my favorite versions. This is the pinboard Tom York. Looks like one of these nail boards you press your face into. And also the Lego Tom York. You can see the whole video kind of playing out through Lego blocks. And there was lots of kind of really fun experimentation. More recently, somebody even 3D printed a version of Tom York's head, which I thought was kind of creepy but pretty cool. So this is, as I said, I think one of the coolest parts of this project was the fact that everybody was kind of participating in it. And I think nicely juxtaposed to some of the Mechanical Turk projects, everybody here knew what it was that they were doing and were kind of engaged and excited together. So that was somewhat the inspiration for a project that I got to work on more recently with my friend Chris Milk, who's another music video director. And we were talking about some of the collaborative projects that I had done in the past when he got approached by Rick Rubin to create a project or music video for Johnny Cash's final album. It's called Ain't No Grave. And the lyrics to the song are, "Ain't no grave can hold my body down." So we thought it was kind of a really appropriate theme for getting people to work together to basically resurrect Johnny Cash, or at least create a living monument to remember him by. So Chris cut together a bunch of archival footage, and we kind of made a short music video, but that no one will ever see, and instead fed the frames from that music video into a drawing tool where each person could draw a portrait of Johnny Cash and create their own kind of individual piece that would be folded into the video. So here you can see a few of the frames that people were drawing. Basically, if you go to the johnnycashproject.com, what you get is the ability to watch the video or contribute to the project. And if you choose to watch the video, you see the video will be playing in the upper corner, and there's this growing kind of list of stalactites. And those are all the individual contributions of different frames that people have drawn to participate in the project. And when you roll over it, you can see who the person is, where they're from. And if you click on an individual frame, you can again see the image and also the way that it was drawn, similar to the sheep market, where you can get a sense of how they did it. And then you also see the artist's name, their location, how long they spent drawing it. And you have the ability to rate the frame so that in the stalactites, it'll begin to bubble up to the top based off the highest rated, as well as the styles. So when you create the drawing, you can also say, this is drawn kind of with a pointillist way, or with a realistic way, or a sketchy way, or an abstract way. And that metadata allows you to then later sort the video to see different versions of it. And again, you can see the highest rated as rated by the community, or there's also a director's cut version that Chris and I worked on editing. And the whole project's kind of constantly rebuilding itself, so twice a day, it basically re-renders all the contributions in the different versions. So rather than talk about it more, I'm just going to show you a short clip that gives a little bit of context, and then I'll show the clip that of the video itself.
I was first shown the Johnny Cash Project through my mom. She knew I loved Johnny, she knew I loved drawing, so when I checked out the website, I was completely blown away. I got to see people's artwork flashing before my eyes, just different images, but always following this cohesive video storyline.
The whole video was full of hauntingly beautiful imagery and symbolism that worked absolutely perfectly with Johnny's song. The frames were somewhat randomly distributed, and he had a limited choice of tools and textures. So really, your main focus was just in what you wanted to say.
It was like this organic thing that was always changing because people would be submitting and submitting, and you could see hundreds of variations of the same video. What better way to pay tribute to the man than to make something for one of his songs?
I felt really sad when he died, and I just thought it would be wonderful, it would be really nice to contribute something to his memory.
It really allows this last recording of his to be a living, breathing memorial. I am honored to have inadvertently made a contribution to something so magical.
For all of the frames to be drawn by fans, each individual frame, it's got a very powerful feeling to it.
It's just amazing to see so many Johnny Cash fans collaborate on some of his final work. The artists that contributed, I mean, I've seen everybody from Japan, Venezuela, to the States, you know, to Knoxville, Tennessee.
As much as it's different from frame to frame, it really is personal.
Watching back the video from my stream, I could see me not understanding at the beginning of it, and I just worked and worked through problems until my little wee battles that I was fighting within the picture all began to resolve themselves. You can actually see the point where I know what I'm doing when a light and a dark comes into it. And in a weird way, that's what I actually like about Johnny Cash's music as well. It's the sum total of his life, all the things that have happened. You know, the bad things, the good things, you're hearing a person's life.
His relationship with the master has helped me in my own personal spiritual struggle and journey through life.
I didn't know that I could connect to someone from such a different background as mine, and for it to mean quite as much as it does.
There ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise right out of the ground. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Well, look way down the river, and what do you think I see? I see a band of angels, and they're coming after me. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. Well, look down yonder, Gabriel. Put your feet on the land and sea. But Gabriel, don't you blow your trumpet till you hear from me. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Jesus, meet me in the middle of the air. And if these wings don't fail me, I will meet you anywhere. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. Well, meet me, mother and father. Meet me down the river road. And mama, you know that I'll be there when I check in, my Lord. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down.
So I actually just found out a couple days ago that it's nominated for Grammy for Best Music Video this year. So fingers crossed on that. This is a website that I work on at Google called Chrome Experiments. So this is one of the experiments on Chrome Experiments by my friend Ricardo, also known as Mr. Doob. And it's just using HTML5, which is kind of a technology we're all pretty excited about. But it's rendering the Google homepage in a bit of a more fun way. And if you can actually find the search bar, you can type in your search query. And it'll continue to. Kind of a fun one. And so Chrome Experiments is basically a gallery where people are showing off JavaScript and HTML5 tricks and some of the kind of fun stuff that you can do with it. There's a few different types of experiments. There's like this is showing basically you can create a world that you can bounce this browser ball into, and it's showing kind of multi-threading and also just this rethinking the idea of kind of what it means to be using browser windows. And some of the experiments on here, this is another, this is a 3D rendering engine for Canvas that my friend Dean made, kind of just showing how you can do some really fun stuff just using HTML5. Some of the experiments on here kind of led Chris and I to thinking about how we could rethink what a music video should be online. We kind of worked with Arcade Fire to make a music experience for their album Wilderness Down, or for the track The Wilderness Downtown off their new album. And we basically were thinking, why does it have to be constrained to this 4x3 box? If we have the browser to play with, why don't we try to break it out and kind of play out through multiple windows and use a bunch of basically the capabilities of the browser in some unique and interesting ways? So one of the things that we did was pull in a bunch of live data sets. If you look at Johnny Cash Project, it was basically thousands of different people all working together to build one isolated thing. And with this project, it was more about pulling in from a bunch of different data sources a different version of the video for each individual person. So it's pulling in stuff from maps and satellite imagery. And I'll just show you a really brief overview of what the experience looked like if you play with it. The world was a changing fast. The world was a changing fast. Hope there's something pure can last. Hope there's something pure can last. So this one's a little trickier to talk about because it's so experiential and it's also very much personally driven. So it starts off by you typing in your own address, and then what you'll realize is as the storyline's playing out about this child kind of running through this neighborhood, you realize that it's actually taking place in the neighborhood that you grew up in. So it's pulling in street view imagery and satellite imagery and kind of tailoring it to each individual specifically. If you get a chance to try it, it's thewildernessdowntown.com. The last project that I'm going to talk about is an installation that's here locally at San Jose International Airport. Basically used this material called privacy glass. So this is one of my collaborators, Dan Goods, and there was also Nick Hoffermas working on the project with me. And basically this material, privacy glass, turns transparent to opaque with electrical charge. So we hung a massive grid of these pieces of privacy glass in the terminal. There's about 3,000 of these pieces up there making this virtual cloud. what we're able to do is take data from the NOAA, looking at weather from across the world in real time, and basically have the virtual travel for this cloud, where it moves from one location to another, reflecting abstractly the weather patterns in that location. So this is a shot of how it looks. It looks very different at different times of the day because it's kind of playing heavily off of the ambient light and whether sunlight's shining through it or not. But what you have is these patterns being pushed through it. We get from the NOAA wind speed, wind direction, basically cloud cover and various other weather condition reports. And those are all visualized on this column that's there in the terminal as well. This is so basically a black pedestal that has a virtual representation of what the cloud's showing up top, and then shows all the conditions that are driving the visualization and the location that it's currently residing in. And it just moves from one location to another, showing the weather data throughout the day. And that's pretty much all that I had planned to talk about for the day. Happy to answer questions. Thanks a lot. Anybody have any questions? Yeah.
So the thing that you just showed, it's a rather lovely piece. I know I've waited in San Jose Airport and spent time watching it. But the last thing that you said was that it showed the weather from different places. And my experience of it was very much that it didn't show the weather from different places. It's a lovely object. I liked watching the pretty patterns in it. But I wouldn't describe it as showing the weather. Can you talk a little bit about that tension between the aesthetics of the objects? I mean, I think this applies to a lot of stuff you're talking about. Between the aesthetics of the objects and the desire to actually show some kind of information behind it.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's... So a lot of the projects that I've been working on, they have different motivations, each one of them. And I think that this one very much resides on the more... motivation is not to literally express the weather. I guess that's why I can... I think you get a lot when you get away with a lot when you're thrown in the category of art, because that piece in particular, even though it's data driven, is very much about kind of more about you thinking about what's happening here. With there's real life data and real life kind of there's this collection of information and it's being expressed more abstractly. There's this interesting process of kind of communication and manifestation. Here's a physical phenomenon that's being digitized, and then re-representing that in physical space. I haven't done too many physical projects because there's so many interesting restrictions that, and the timeline of this project was 3 years. I'm used to spending 3 weeks on something. But I think it was a kind of a really refreshing experience to be working tangibly and to be thinking about that. But the purpose of it definitely was not to be analytical, despite the fact there's this somewhat analytical display that's giving you that data. It's really about kind of parameterized form. And I think if you actually watch it long enough, it's more about kind of thinking about the thought process to try to visualize these parameters in this form, where you know certain visualizations are really obvious. It's easy to show snow, and it's easy to show wind speed and direction. Which, if you watched it, you could actually derive that information because it's the speeds are all relative, and they're actually flowing the direction that the wind would be flowing in. So, if you really tried, you could put yourself into that space. And I think that's a little bit more of what it's about. Is kind of like it is. Being able to put yourself in the headspace of what that would be like, and also just having it something that's kind of that's pleasant. And the airport experience is kind of a challenging one because everybody's stressed out. And I think this is we had a lot of constraints to think about, both politically and organizationally, but also kind of in terms of thinking about what the experience was like for the traveler, and in terms of thinking about kind of how could we make that more pleasant and less painful. I think there's plenty of very analytical and very useful ways to represent the data, and it wasn't needed in that space. And in that sense, it's more about kind of a celebration than it is about being useful, at least in the traditional way. Yeah.
I notice you use a lot of the sort of spindly lines in your visualizations, and as well as in the Arcade Fire video. Mm-hmm. Is there a particular motivation for why you're attracted to those?
That is a really interesting question.
Like the flight patterns, for example.
Yeah. No, I know exactly what you mean. I am really attracted to very fine lines. I think I was heavily influenced by my professor, Casey Reese, who created one of the co-creators of processing programming language. And I think as a tool, processing lends itself very easily to making artwork like his, which is dealing with lots of small agents and kind of, I'm really interested in complexity. I think one of the most interesting things about kind of processor power evolution is that it now enables us to make these highly complex things that differentiate themselves very clearly from a lot of natural processes. So I think I find the visual really intriguing, and I think the medium is really well suited to create that kind of visual complexity, which I really like. Yeah.
I was moved by your Johnny Cash project, and particularly the fact that it drew so much inspiration and so many creative people to do that video. And my question is about projects that similar to that draw upon the work of the masses to address something like global warming, species preservation, something like that. I know there are lots of people at Google that are concerned with those, like Larry Brilliant. And, I'm just wondering if you've interacted with people like that to assist them.
I've interacted with Larry Brilliant a bit. He's actually my cousin, which is a bizarre overlap. But I think that there's a lot of kind of happening in that space. I think the power of the masses is just beginning to kind of be harnessed to its productive potential. Wikipedia is the obvious and great example of that. But I think that there's going to be more and more kind of self-assembling communities. It's really just a matter of providing the proper platform. And then when it comes to physical things, it's really easy when you have intellectual challenges. It's very easy to kind of tackle these. But when it comes to, I think that there's a lot of work that needs to be done in incentive structures to begin to take the power of this and actually move it into making tangible change. And I'm optimistic that will begin to happen, but the platforms don't seem to be building as quickly as one might hope. But yeah, it's definitely something that Google, I think, is very interested in, and hopefully we'll see a lot more of. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I just want to follow up with the Cash project. So how does it work? What's in the behind? People draw the pictures? You have a program to...
Yeah, I kind of skimmed over that a little too quickly, but thanks for asking. Basically, an important part of the project was kind of democratizing the tool. So when you go to participate in the project, everybody's using the same drawing tool. It's not like some guy's opening up Maya and rendering out like 12 hours of beautiful 3D content. It's a really simple drawing tool that is also limited by color, which is kind of an important aspect of it. So it has an onion skinning thing, and also kind of like a rotoscoping style tool where you can have, so it helps people to align. You can basically use it to the extent that you want to, but the source imagery is there as kind of a guide. So you when you go to the website, during the early stages when it was all black and actually being drawn in by individual people, people didn't have a choice of what frame. There were three frames that were presented to them and they could pick which one they wanted to contribute to. Now that the whole video has kind of revealed itself and you can actually watch it, you can click on any individual frame and say, I want to draw this one, or I think this one should be drawn better. And you can click on that frame and then you have that as a base print. And you can basically model your drawing off of that. You can either go right in and copy it very literally, or you can just look at it and then go make a drawing. But the drawing tool is there to basically help people keep kind of some cohesion. Because if everybody draws out of place, you're not going to get this effect of the video flowing through all the different drawings. And also, it limits the color scale so that everything's kind of within the tone that's appropriate, at least on a color level, not necessarily the themes. And some of the abstract images, people really go crazy. There's some pretty fun ones like teddy bears and kind of craziness happening. But there's really unique interpretations. And I think that's part of what the metadata was also trying to do is like, allow people to see a realistic and literal version, but also just explore and see the kind of the more tangential versions, which are also really exciting and kind of creative in a different way. Does that answer the question? Yeah.
Most of the collective art projects you showed had individuals kind of filling in a particular template, whether it's like an individual frame within a film or a little pixel. Yeah. Have you ever tried having some project where it's really more originative than that, where they're kind of producing their own sequence of frames?
Yeah, I'm actually working on a project that heads down that path with my friend Ricardo right now, and he's already done some experiments that are pretty successful in that. He did a thing called multi-user sketchpad, which is basically a space where it opens socket connections, and as people start drawing, they're all drawing in the same space. So you only see what you see that elapses while your browser's there and open. It's not like a building image. But for me, a lot of those experiments have, if they're too open-ended, and you don't give people kind of a purpose, then you end up with a penis effect, which honestly it happens in all of these projects as well, the 600 of those 662. But anyway, I think you need to give them. I think you need to give some fundamental framework and some guidance to like push things a direction. One project that I think handles that really well is a lesser known project called Swarm Sketch, which is a little bit like multi-user sketchpad, but they put a title on it before it gets started. So everybody can contribute one single line, and as they, you can basically vote up and down the opacity of other individual lines that have been contributed, and it'll just say like airplane. And then you have thousands of people kind of trying to draw an airplane, and you get this really kind of schizophrenic distributed creation, which is kind of amazing. It's one of my favorite crowdsource projects. But yeah, I think you have to give some framework, otherwise you're just gonna end up with junk, largely. And it's actually not junk. I shouldn't be so mean. Like, if you look at 4chan community, you see lots of stuff emerge that's actually really interesting on a bunch of different levels, but not stuff I'm as interested in trying to create. Yeah?
I love this. So many great, like, finished products. Can you talk a little bit about your process, how you get to these? What are some of the failures, perhaps, that come along the way?
I guess for me, the failures are the ones that I don't follow through with enough to have them be kind of more finished things. But I guess in a way, those aren't really failures because they usually lead to some revelation about why it ought to be completely different and be more polished. But my process is pretty much driven by curiosity. It's here's something that's intriguing, and if I find it intriguing, I can probably show others why I think it's interesting as well. I don't know if that really answers the question, but the process is very natural and felt out.
Do you create lots of variations, or do you just kind of have an idea and go straight forward, or?
Well, because I've used processing and libraries similar to processing for creating a lot of the work, it ends up being really iterative and really fast to iterate on. So I can kind of never actually make something that's a failure because it's just one attempt and then quickly change it. And I think it is a lot more like sculpture than it is like engineering. I don't have a blueprint laid out for what I'm going to make. It's like start making it and see what it's going to, and that's not always the case. Sometimes I have a better sense of what I'm aiming for. But especially with the DataViz stuff, it's easy to just do a number of quick experiments to see what is the data saying for this or that, and then polish it and refine it until it's actually showing something that seems interesting or is related to my interest in it. Does that answer the question a little better? Yeah.
Do you know what's happening in the health area? You looked at the aviation stuff. There's all this data.
Yeah. There's a guy, Eric Schatt, who was just, so Esquire just did this short Best and Brightest feature and introduced me to a bunch of other really interesting folks. And Eric is one of them who is doing a lot of, an epidemiologist, but he's also looking, one of his projects is looking at kind of like spread of disease by sampling sewage and also sampling like public transport stuff. And it seems like he's got a couple tracks because he's also really interested in kind of like systems thinking when it comes to medicine and kind of holistic may be the wrong word, but looking at basically, yeah, like how larger systems are interacting, not just targeting one particular effect, but how an interplay of medicine can also work together. This stuff's completely fascinating to me, and I'm hoping to work with him. He has some truly fascinating data that needs to be visualized, because when you look at it as numbers, it doesn't know. S-C-H-A-D-T, I think, Eric. I think he's with Pacific. If you Google him, it'll come up. Yeah. Pacific Biosciences, I think it is. Any other questions? Yeah?
It's actually a couple. The first one is about the airport's visualization.
when air traffic controllers, or maybe even National Defense, when they saw that visualization, did it influence their conceptual model? Did they see anything that maybe enlightens their awareness? The second one is about just HTML5 and the features of it as a user-based designer. What are you really excited about recently?
In terms of the first question, I think I got a huge response from ATC folks and from people in the airline industry in general. I think lots of ATC guys are used to seeing images similar to these, but just for their airport and just for their particular region. If you look at all the NASA guys saw this stuff, and they're like, yeah, we see that every day. But the version they see, of course, is little green airplanes going dik, dik, dik. So I think that they responded a little bit in like, there were different levels. There was definitely huge excitement about it, though. And I think if anything, it was nice because it helped to give a lot of other folks some appreciation for some of the chaos that they're dealing with, and just kind of the kind of ballet that's happening on a daily basis. Since I've seen some other visualizations, I've been trying to get the data for it of basically mapping weather patterns on top of that, and looking at some of the really amazing dances that they're doing to skirt around approaching storms. And I think adding that extra data on top of it really adds a lot. I've also been doing some visualizations more recently of Katrina, and you can see kind of the way the systems are responding. I still don't know exactly how I feel about turning that into like art in a way. It's a little morbid, but it's fascinating. It's really interesting stuff. In terms of HTML5, I think it's super exciting. It's still obviously not completely implemented in all browsers, and but there's tons of fun stuff popping up. Like accelerometer is just going to be coming out in the near future. Tons of like fun, interesting things. And I think it's just huge to be able to have open standards that can work cross-platform on tons of different types of devices, and begin to see the same stuff being able to be built for mobile devices as your TV, as your computer, and it's fun stuff. Any other questions? Yeah.
Question about the Johnny Cash project. Do you notice any trends in the images that people submit over time? They get better.
Yeah.
Or
it's actually funny because if you compare a historical analysis looking at analytics, you can see we didn't really have any kind of PR marketing strategy behind it. We just launched it. We told a bunch of our friends, and you'll see it hits like a country music blog, and you just get a barrage of like tons of images. Not necessarily the highest caliber, and then it'll hit like an art blog, and you'll just get like super nice, like finely detailed images, and you can basically see, kind of as it hit each blog, what types of images are coming off of each one. And what's really interesting is to watch the approaches that different people take. You can see the dramatic difference from somebody who has like a fine arts training to somebody who's just an enthusiast. Whereas it's almost a little bit troubling because you'll watch people off the country music blog in particular that go in and they start tackling details just right off the get-go, and there's just like this really nice face in the middle of the thing, and then it just starts trying to like build out the rest of the image, and it's just a very different process than you get from somebody who like comes in, does the wash, starts building out the lines. And but that said, some of the people who see it through, who started with the details, end up with amazing images as long as they're willing to see it out and like continue that detailed process throughout the whole frame. But there's definitely a lot of different strategies when it comes to drawing, and I find it fascinating to watch. And there's definitely different kinds of images from different locations. Yeah?
Is the drawing tool something you wrote, or is it something that's available?
Yeah, also my friend Ricardo, Mr. Dube, helped me to build it out. I wrote the drawing tool for the sheet market, and then also for 10,000 cents. First one was processing Java applet, and then realized that only 10% of the people viewing the hit could actually do it because nobody had Java installed in their browsers. So then I switched to Flash, and then got tons of people. And the latest version that he built is Flash, and then the newest one that he did is a HTML5, a canvas drawing tool.
Yeah. Could you say something about how you find the difference working in Flash versus HTML5? Is HTML5 slower?
Slower is a pretty subjective thing when it comes to HTML5, especially because it's determined not only by your computer, but by the browser that you're using. And browsers are rapidly changing. So now the latest browsers are using hardware accelerated canvas, which kind of blows Flash out of the water. but it's not really a fair comparison because you're looking at a software renderer versus a hardware accelerated renderer. And not everybody has it. So what's a really crazy fast experience for somebody might be a slower experience for someone else. I find it to be basically virtually the same. It's a slightly different syntax, but there's also libraries that are built on top of it. So if you're willing to take a slight performance hit, you can use something like Processing.js, which is a JavaScript version of processing, which allows you to use really simple code, and actually the same code that you would use if you were using processing online with Canvas. Yeah.
One thing I've noticed in the sort of years since Mechanical Turk started was that you no longer really can pay a penny or two just because of the dynamics of the market or the types of people participating. Mm. Do you see that influencing your future? Do you see yourself using Mechanical Turk again, or have you been able to track these sort of changes where now you have to pay a quarter or 50 cents or even a buck for someone to get any sort of quality of work?
Yeah. Well, I think Mechanical Turk is definitely not like a cohesive community. It's constantly changing from when I did the first task. So I there's no real analytics that they give you, but I was tracking the IPs and doing some lookups and stuff. The first sheep stuff was coming vastly from North America, mostly American people from like .edu domains and folks who were trying it out and figuring out what it was about. And that was a very different environment than the audio project. You could already see it was vastly overseas and it'd become a lot more about India. If you go to 10,000cents.com, there's a breakdown of some of the percentages for different countries. And I think with the region changes also comes changes in motivation. But one thing that's been fairly consistent through Mechanical Turk is that most of the tasks are horribly mundane and painful. So it's audio transcription, translation, things that actually computers almost could do, but they not quite as well. Whereas if you create a creative task, I think what you see is that the cost barrier goes way down. It's like, oh, I get to do something that doesn't suck. Sweet. I'll take a penny for like a 5-minute break of doing something cool. And that's what I think you're seeing in the sheep, is that people were not doing 46-minute tasks for 2 cents. And I think that aspect hasn't changed, that motivation. If you can make a task, then there's several motivators that I think are really valid. One is make it fun. And the other is like give them some credit for it. Like, if they're working on this thing and they have no idea what it's for, and it's painful, and they're never getting any credit or any validation for it, then it's probably not going to work very well. But if you look at other things, I mean, Wikipedia is like, they're not getting paid anything, and there's a massive amount of work. And even for that, it's very low attribution. But they still feel like they're a part of something and like working together to build something cool. So I think those motivating factors. But I'm not sure if I use Mechanical Turk again. I'm a lot more interested in getting people contextually. But there definitely are some things that it's valuable for. Yeah, and giving context even within your Mechanical Turk thing is probably a good way of doing it. And I actually talked with somebody from Amazon, and they were talking about that aspect about it. At least they were acknowledging that requesters who give context get better results. Any other questions?
Thank you, Aaron.
Cool, my pleasure. Thanks a lot.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.